I'm Gordon McBean. I'm an environmental scientist from Canada, and I work as president of the International Council for Science on global issues of science and society.
What was 10-year-old Gordon like?
When I was 10 years old, I'm not sure what I was thinking about things, because it's a long time ago, I'd have to say. I won't admit how old I really am. When I was 10 years old, I was fascinated by issues of history and society and actually geography, of the idea of maps and being able to see things. And I was very much encouraged by my parents. So my father had always wanted to go to university, but he never had the chance to. He grew up on a farm and it was his job to work on the farm. But he wanted his sons to go to university. So we had a family environment that encouraged us. So when I was 10 years old, I'm not quite sure what I was thinking, but actually only a few years after I was 10 years old, I guess I would have been 13, I watched and looked to the sky, standing on my front porch with my mom and dad and my two brothers, and we looked to the sky and there was a dot of light going through the sky, up there, way up there. It was Sputnik. The first time any society had been able to put in space a satellite, a human instrument, going up and around the world. And it fascinated me. I will always remember that. And rather incidentally, the reason why Sputnik went up in 1957, I've discovered years later, was because it was the International Council for Science organized the International Geophysical Year and basically challenged the science community globally, who can be the first one to put it there? And the Russians won, in a sense. But more importantly, it inspired a lot of people. And I think, as I said, it had a very positive influence on me as an example of how scientific groups working together. I didn't know quite how it was done then, but they put it up there. That's going around the world, like the moon does. Not quite as far up, but nonetheless. And that I will always remember.
How did you become a scientist?
I was not quite sure when I was young was what I really wanted to be. I studied history and science and things, but as I went to university, the sciences of physics and chemistry and mathematics kind of intrigued me, and I went into that area and then evolved into studying and applying that information to issues like climate change and weather and that kind of thing. So my science background evolved more through, let's say, exploring different opportunities, possibilities, the way you could do things. So that's why I became the scientist that I have become.
You gave a speech about global warming in 1995, more than 20 years ago. What do you think has changed in the last 20 years?
Well, global warming is an issue that actually, from the science community, really goes back many decades. In fact, the first paper written on it was written in 1824 by a French mathematician, Fourier. But as a science issue that brought to government's attention started really in the 1980s with the International Council for Science and other organizations convening groups of scientists to say, climate is already changing. We should become concerned about it. And at that time, I chaired the World Climate Research Program's International Scientific Committee, so I got involved in these things and helped set up the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change and these kind of things. But in 1995, we put out the first statement in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change that said the balance of evidence suggests a discernible human influence on the climate system. The idea was to say that it's there, but we're not totally sure of how and which way. Over the years since then, more than 20 years now, there has been an evolution, first of all, of our climate system. It is getting warmer. 2014 was the warmest year on record at that time. 2015 beat it out. 2016 beat it out again. So we've had three successive warmest years on record of the time of humans measuring these things. We also have seen a progression in the science to better understand how the physical, chemical, biological, and other processes in the climate system are working in a way that we can actually say, yes, that kind of change could not have just been happening by chance. It's happening directly related to the amount of human-caused carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. So the situation has changed dramatically over the last 20 years from a very likely, but not, let's say, firmly deduced decision to one that where we have to take action.
How do you think we can manage it?
Well, the climate change situation, I think, is very, very serious. And we need to, first of all, as scientists, explain it better to societies and understand, as I said at the presentation I actually made to the Canadian cabinet some years ago when I was challenged, well, why would we do this? And I said, do you have children and grandchildren? I do. Because it's our children and grandchildren which will see the real negative impacts of climate change. And so first of all, we have to use the science, the very important and very stable, solid base of science that we have, to convince the public, convince the policymakers that the issue is something they need to address by somewhat appealing to them in a more political way than scientists are used to doing. And then work with the communities of engineers, the stakeholders, the municipalities, governments at all level, to find the ways of both reducing our emissions so that we don't have runaway greenhouse gas warming by the end of the century. But at the same time, we have to recognize that because of the way the climate system works, we have to adapt to the fact that over the next 20, 30, 40 years, we've already put in place a momentum that will cause the climate to change in ways that we need to adapt to it. And that means changing the way we build homes, roads, way we use water, worrying about flooding zones and things. So there's a number of societal things. And there's where we really also have to deal with the issues of international society issues, justice as we call it, and international and intergenerational equity and ethics is what I call it. That it's largely a problem created by the industrialized world. It's not what we put in last year. It's what we put in the last 100 years into the atmosphere. And that means it's not just because China did the biggest emissions last year, they're the worst. They're not doing well, but they are actually addressing the problem much more than certain people seem to think they are. And I think we should build with these groups of people to find ways and helping people in developing countries who don't have the resources, who don't have the knowledge, the technologies, etc., to give them the assistance to help them adapt, change their ways so they don't become 40 years from now the developed world of the last 20 years, but instead a different kind of society that is positive and beneficial for all.
There are still scientists who deny that climate change is happening or that it's happening because of human impact. How important is a collaboration of the scientific community on this issue?
Yeah, the climate change issue, because of its economic importance to certain sectors of our society, is one for which there are reasons that certain scientists will speak out and, let's say, cast doubt on that the climate really is changing. And I've become involved in this much more than I perhaps thought I would have decades ago, and because I think it's important. It's essential that the science community work together to communicate the science information we know, and occasionally have to be openly critical of certain scientists who claim to be climate scientists. Most of them in reality are not highly credentialed scientists, but we have to work together as a community. And one of the things we need to do is learn how to better communicate. We need to learn how to, let's say, convey the messages in a way that people can understand it. As a rather ironic story, when I was a University of British Columbia professor in the 80s and 90s, I volunteered to a program called the Scientists in the Schools program, and I would go and sit on the floor with kids in grade 4, 5, and 6, whichever the teacher wanted, and discuss climate change or ozone depletion or whatever issue, but often climate change, and explain it in a way that they could understand it in their enthusiasm, but give them the kind of things that they could see and understand. And then later, when I became an assistant deputy minister, I was briefing one of my ministers, and after I had briefed the minister, other assistant deputy minister said, "Wow, Gordon, how did you learn to brief ministers? You're just new in the job." I said, "Well, whatever you do, don't tell the minister. But I did what I did when I taught to kids in grade 4, 5, and 6. You learn a way to explain things in a way that can be understood by, because very few ministers in any government have science background."
You are attending the Global Young Academy annual meeting. How important is your collaboration?
Well, I think the we need to understand, as part of this process of learning how to communicate by interacting with scientists of, let's say, different backgrounds, different disciplines, different geographies, racial, religion, other backgrounds, because that's really important to understand the dimensions of a global issue. And an organization like the Global Young Academy and the International Council for Science in an older general way are organizations that bring together the science community from across the globe that we can learn from each other. We can learn amazing amounts just being here for 2 or 3 days now and talking over breakfast and dinner with young scientists. I learn, well, gosh, I didn't know that. And so organizations like the Global Young Academy can develop that very positive interaction and learning process among younger scientists. And they can also, because they represent, in a sense, the next generation, they are part of that children and grandchildren kind of view, in a sense, certainly children. And in a way that hopefully will then convey that importance of addressing environmental issues, climate change, but others, many. There's many others. It's not just climate change. And also, more importantly, generally, is building our governmental policies based on the very best science. In the very broad definition of that word, I define science to include psychology, sociology, cultural issues, linguistics issues, as well as math, physics, and chemistry, and getting those kind of issues brought together in a way that people in the political world and hopefully the general public overall, because politicians live to listen to the public. In most countries, their main objective is to get reelected, and they will get reelected if they feel they are addressing the issues that the public want. So we need to work together, and the young scientists of GYA, Global Young Academy, are very important as part of that process of conveying the importance of these science issues. And we have to emphasize the value of evidence-based policy for societies and the fact that there often are solutions. We just have to find them, work together to implement them, develop them, enhance them as we go along and learn from things. So I think the Global Young Academy can play a role in very clearly helping with doing good science, developing young people to be motivated to do the kind of science we need, not be motivated by the number of dollars they're going to make, but motivated by the societal benefits of the outputs, the outcomes of their programs and research. But if we can then work together, Global Young Academy, Global Old Academicians, can work together in ways that can make a big difference for all.
What is the most important lesson that you have learned from your research?
Well, I think, first of all, I have been studying science for a long time, and then I got involved in policy issues quite a while ago. And so I've learned how we need to, as a scientific community, work together with the policy makers in a way that does not allow them to overwhelm us, but allows us to understand how they see issues so we can get the support we need in order to undertake the very best science. And we need to work in teams. Some people's expertise is not in communications. Their expertise is in solving that physics problem. And that's not to be in any way negative. But we need to have them working with teams, with those who have communication skills, certain kinds of outreach skills, in a way that the team together can make a big difference.
What motivates you?
I do have children and grandchildren, as I've said, and I think it's so important that we as scientists not just walk away and say, okay, I've had enough, I'm done for that issue. I feel motivated, and I get a large amount of personal satisfaction out of working with groups of people around the world. I find it very inspiring in a way to meet with people from different countries and learn about them and learn about how their society functions and realize that my own background is different, not worse or better, just different. But between us, we can bring those things together that make us overall better. And to me, that's a kind of a reward for life.
Do you have a dream?
When I look to the future, I think, looking back, I think, well, all these things have happened, and I look to the future and hope that there will be an evolution in a way that some of the right-wing tendencies in society that have been happening recently are not replicated, that they become short-term aberrations, disturbances that have happened. But let's look to the future and hope there is a more general sense of a global community of working together, that people understand that we actually prosper better when we work together than when we counter each other. That we should encourage the interplay, the interaction, the working together of different disciplines, different, but more importantly, different genders, different groups of racial, religious, whatever backgrounds. That those shouldn't be the factors. It should be a common good kind of approach. And I'm hoping, I'm relatively optimistic that if we keep working together as the science community and join in with other groups who are also thinking the same way, that collectively we can make a very positive difference.
Thank you so much, Gordon.
Thank you.